great day where we're going to split the sky and Jesus is coming back. Amen. I'm going to be tonight. So that morning when the flood is over, I'll fly away to my home. Oh, God's blessing is yours. I'll fly away. Sit out, fly away, oh glory. Fly away. Clap with me.
Thank you.
revival, hallelujah. Revival's coming, hallelujah. And the revival needs to be in our hearts even before it shows up. Let's believe God together. Let's surrender our ideas, amen, and all our plans and thoughts for what He wants to do. And that is
bring revival here.
Revival.
We bow our hearts.
above all things, all principalities and powers and rulers of this earth. Amen. Amen. It's good to be in church. Let's begin to ask God for things and ask God for great things. Amen. For miracles. Let's pray for our leaders. Pastor Mitchell's congregation, Prescott, Arizona. Amen. Greg Mitchell, Lisa's wife, as they are now leading our great fellowship. Amen. Of almost 2,800 churches throughout the entire world. We're so thankful for the vision of Wayman Mitchell and all that God has done. And you and I would not be here unless it was through their faithfulness, through their dedication throughout the years. Thank God for Prescott, Arizona. Let's pray for Pastor Jesse and Pastor Diego that are assisting there. And Pastor Chiaco, too. Did you put his name up there yet? We're back of screen. Hallelujah. We're still in Prescott.
Yep.
Stephen and Emily Chiaccio, amen, for their help there. They've just put on staff. Amen. There's a great need there in Prescott. Let's also pray for our leaders, the Campos and the Ganiers, and the rally that's coming up this weekend in Cape Cod, Massachusetts. Let's pray for all the workers, the laborers, the pastors and wives and families that are going to be nurtured there and helped, amen, in that rally. Let's also pray for the Suspanskys and the Kings in Jacksonville, hallelujah, our Southeast Conference Center. Let's pray for Pastor Keith and Carrie Sullivan. I want you to know that God is moving in East Rochester. They had three people born again on Wednesday and back in church on Sunday morning. That's a miracle, hallelujah. That's wonderful, man. That's exciting. We had a couple visitors this morning, and one of the women had responded. She came to the altar and she prayed for salvation. It's exciting to be doing something for God in the end of all times. Amen. In this specific time here and in history, amen, here in Greece, New York, what God is doing, man, it's exciting to be part of God's plan. Let's pray for that church and all their converts and those altars there to be filled. Let's pray for our altars here to be filled with people that are repentant, people that want to do God's will. Let's pray for visitors and amen, converts to return here, and those who are away, those who are being affected by COVID-19, who can't make it to our services. We have many prayer requests of people that are online watching our services, maybe some older folks, but let's pray for them. Let's pray for people that are away. Also, let's pray for Brother Smitty. Let's pray for Catherine. Let's pray for Angelo, amen, recovering from, amen, his surgery. Many of these people have some serious heart conditions. Joe Graziano recovering from his cancer treatments. Let's pray for these people that we met and prayed with on outreach, David and Michael. Let's pray for Bill and Kim from the Greece area up here, Denise Avenue. David and Michael, amen. Let's pray for people that are coming to Christ, that are getting saved, man. That's where it's at. That's where it all begins. Humble hearts. Let's pray for breakthrough for the Greece church. Let's pray for the family of John Newcomb, who passed away last month, amen, Kelsey, and his family there. Let's also pray for the return. God is moving in all of New York and throughout the East Coast and Washington, D.C. There's meetings going on. People are having revival. You can look it up online. People are getting baptized in the streets of Minneapolis, amen, and all over, amen. We're hearing testimonies in our fellowship of people getting saved online, getting saved at outreaches, getting saved and coming to church services because they heard somebody street preaching and they went to the church and they found out that there's a church here, amen, and God is moving here. And perhaps you have a need in your life, something I did not mention, amen. I have a list of 25 names here of people that I'm praying for. Amen. Lift them up in prayer. These are people who got saved, amen, and are in connection to us, in contact with us, amen. Let's also pray for Dan and Stacy. Let's believe God for miracles and many other couples to be added here. Perhaps you have a need that I did not mention and you're online. We want to pray for you. We want to just knit our hearts with you. We want to believe, God, for your condition, whatever you're going through, the things that you're suffering through, amen, whether you've lost a job, you have economic problems, you're looking for a job, there's relationship difficulties, you want to be delivered and set free from a bondage, amen. Jesus can do that. He's the same God today. Amen. God showed me what to tell people on outreach the other day. Many people say that the book, the Bible is outdated and it's not relevant. Amen. They say it's an ancient book. But I say to you that we have ancient problems and there's answers in that book for your life. We have racism. We have prejudice. We have anger. We have there's witchcraft in the Bible. There's witchcraft today. There's things that people are suffering through, loneliness, anxiety. Amen. And the things that you are going through, God can help you with. And I want to encourage you to believe God for your future and your destiny. Put the past behind you. Amen. We're going to go ahead and all pray and ask God to help us. And I'm going to believe God with you together. Brother David, can you open us up in prayer when we subside? Thank you. Lord, we're believing you for the miraculous, God. You're the God of that ancient book, ancient problems, ancient demons, God. You have answers to all our dilemma, God. Move in America. Move powerfully, God. Bring revival to the young people, God. Bring deliverance from every bondage, all perversion, alcohol, and drugs, all rebellion against your plan right now. We bind, we promote the healthy things, the healthy mindsets, deliverance and freedom, and thinking clearly, Lord God, into this generation, God. Help all our churches, God, move in all the earth on every hemisphere, Lord God. Breathe your Holy Spirit upon this service tonight, God. We're expecting you for more miracles, God. We believe you, God, for all your promises. You've called Rochester a net for the nations, God. Put together a work of ethnicities, black people and white people. Give us Latinos and Asians, God, a mixed grouping, Lord God. All kinds of folks, all kinds of cultures, Lord God. Yep. Let Jesus be glorified in these meetings.
Jesus, we ask that you touch us all by your Spirit. Give us a real heart for the people that are going to hell unless they change their mind pretty quick. We ask the Lord for the grace to love them in the kingdom, to be available and answer their questions. We ask the Lord that you touch people and get them saved so that your whole bride may be complete and we can get out of here. We ask it in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. We worship you, Lord. Great to be in church. I want to thank everybody for coming. Hallelujah. Let's take a moment to greet one another and make everybody feel welcome. Let's see if I can remember to record the service. my iPhone 7 here. I did that for the kids at school. They're like, why do you gotta say that, iPhone 7? Why do you gotta talk like that? Amen. It's good to be saved. Hallelujah. And on the right side of the eternal, amen, that is living for Jesus. A few announcements for the local congregation. And that is that we will be back in church on Wednesday night at 7:30 for our service. 6:30 is when we pray, when we gather together and hold of God. We're also going to be outreaching on this Saturday at 11 o'clock. You're welcome to join us. We'll be meeting here at the building at 11 o'clock. Sunday morning is our 10 o'clock adult Sunday school. You're welcome to check out what God is doing. You can learn some things. You can ask questions. You can also give some of your real life experience about living for God and help us all to say that we just finished up an adult Sunday school entitled What It's Like to Be a Friend. And so we studied the book of Proverbs. Amen. And we would like to encourage you to come on next Sunday, 10 o'clock. 10:30 is our worship service in the morning. We'll be preaching and you'll see some more people show up. Hallelujah. Praise God. Let's take a minute here pull an offering, amen, and that is to render unto Caesar. How many know what I'm going to talk about right now? Render unto Caesar. Some people are shaking their heads. Okay. Mark 12:13-17. Then they sent to Jesus some of the Pharisees and the Herodians to catch him in his words. When they had come, they said to him, Teacher, we know that you are true and care about no one, for you do not regard the person of men, but teach the way of God in truth. Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not? Shall we pay or shall we not pay? But he, Jesus, knowing their hypocrisy, he said to them, Why do you test me? Bring me a denarius, or bring me the coin so that I may see it. So they brought it to him, and he said unto them, Whose image and inscription is this? They looked at it. They said, Mickey Mouse. No, Mickey Mouse wasn't on there. They said, Caesar is on there. He is the king. And so Jesus replied, Render therefore unto Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and unto God the things that are God's. And they marveled at him. So what we learn from this scripture, quite simply, is that we, number one, we need to be paying our taxes to the government to pay for the roads and, you know, all the things that help us to travel and to work here in a public, in a society, in a culture here. Amen. And also, and even more importantly, though, when we do pay our taxes, we need to give to God the things that are God's. We give God our time. That's why you're here tonight. We give God our money. Amen. And it's a joy to do both of those things because he is the author and finisher of our faith. He's done so much for us. And we're so thankful for what he's accomplished with us in our lives. And we're going to take a minute here to just show a token of our respect for him and gratitude by the giving of money. Let's ask the usher to come forward. And when you give to God, if you don't have any money, you're welcome here to come. You don't have to pay money to come and hear us preach or sing, whatever. You can come and enjoy this also, but it is a pleasure to give unto God. It is a joy. It is a gladness to be able to let God, you know, have a small token of our finances. Let's make this building self-supporting this year, amen. Pay for the lights. Let's pay for our rent. Let's, amen, see this place double, amen, this year, amen. Let's knock down that wall, hallelujah. Bring your friends here, amen, and let's see God do a revival here in Greece, New York. Amen. It begins with our hearts and our hearts giving, amen. Brother, can you pray over the offering?
Yeah, hallelujah. Offer gifts of what you've given us. We return your portion back to you. We're grateful that your requirements are so small and your blessings are so great. We thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to give into your kingdom. In your name.
Yes, thank you, Lord. Amen. Thank you for your giving online.
Revival, my soul.
To Hebrews 3. We're going to read verses 8 through 15 this evening. Good listening is like tuning in a radio station. For good results, you can listen to only one station at a time. Trying to listen to my wife, this other writer is writing this. He says, I'm looking over my office reports. It's like trying to receive two radio stations coming in at the same time. He says, I end up with distortion and frustration. Listening requires a choice of where I want to place my attention. To tune in to my wife, I must first choose to put away all that will divide my attention. That might mean like laying down the newspaper or getting off the web or whatever you're doing, moving away from the dishes or some project that you're on, putting down a book that you're reading, setting aside projects, amen, and removing the distractions. You want to hear from God? Amen. God wants you to hear him. I've entitled this sermon, Hearing God's Voice, Hebrews 3. Verses 8 through 15. Verse 8. Harden not your heart as in the day of temptation or provocation in the wilderness, the old King James says, when your fathers tempted me and proved me and saw my works for 40 years. Wherefore I was grieved with that generation, God says. They always err in their hearts. They have not known my ways. So I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter into my rest. Take heed, verse 12, brethren, lest there be any one of you with an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God, but exhort one another daily while it is called day, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin, for we are made partakers of Christ if we hold from the beginning of our confidence steadfast all the way through to the end. Verse 15, while it is said, today, if you hear his voice, harden not your hearts as in the day of provocation. I want to say this morning that that woman who came to our church and heard that altar call, she felt the presence of God. She was changed. She was affected by that. She was crying. She was weeping. She was getting saved, I imagine. She was making decisions. And after she got done praying, there was a smile on her face that was very contagious. Amen. And following God and doing what he wants of us, hearing his voice, amen, will bring pleasure to your life as well. I've entitled this quite simply, Hearing God's Voice. Hearing God's voice, if you hear my voice And that your heart hearing from God requires being in church, hearing from God, hearing from maybe preaching. Hearing from God requires praying and talking to God, hearing God's voice through your daily Bible reading or your studying of the scriptures. Amen. Sometimes you got to turn the radio off in the car and just say, dang, God, what do you want me to do? What am I doing with my life? Where am I going? And, you know, remove all the other voices, all the dissonance, all the distractions, and then just sit and listen and see what God says. Paul Stevens, one of our great preachers from out west, he said of hearing the word of God, if you hear the word of God and you hear a preacher and you like what he's saying, you're like, yep, that's God. And then you hear the preacher at another time preaching something and you don't like what he's saying and you don't like it. You say, that's not God. He also said, you know, it's only, you know, his opinion or your opinion when you don't like what you hear coming across the pulpit. Or maybe God's telling you, giving you a direction, you know, serious life decisions. You don't like what he's hearing, what he's saying to you. And so then not hearing from God is like when you were a kid and your mom screams out for you to come home. And then later you finally get home hours later, and you say you didn't hear her screaming. Or it's kind of like if your dad is unwrapping a piece of candy, you could hear that from a mile away. It's kind of funny. We have a selective ability to hear certain things that we want to hear and certain things that we don't want to hear. So, generally speaking, we need to hear from God. How soon is it going to appear? The children of Israel had forgotten so quickly what God had done for them. Amen. In delivering them from slavery and bondage, we find ourselves in this scripture here while they're wandering in the wilderness. Amen. And the writer of Hebrews is referring to this time when they were wandering and they started complaining about what God was doing for them, whether they didn't have any food or they didn't have any water or they were, just wandering. Why do we got to always get up when the cloud moves? And, you know, why do we got to follow? Why do we got to do this? They forgot quickly how a million slaves were set free by miraculous signs. Many times you will see there are different engines of thought, even today, who are attempting to change your perception of history. Can anybody say amen?
Yeah.
They are reinventing what happened. They're rewriting the history books. They're trying to get you to think that something different happened. What was once understood and accepted as fact now becomes questionable. Well, really, did that happen? We choose to listen and to believe whatever agenda our news agency is promoting. You may side with your family or somebody in your life, or you just feel like that's right, and then you just follow a certain train of thought. You're not willing to listen to other people or other things, and pretty soon you see history in a brand new light. Things have changed completely. We hear what we want to hear. It's called selective hearing. We want to believe what we want to believe. Selective listening or selective hearing. Hearing God's voice is the only thing that will get you through this life. Can anybody say amen? We are so desperately lost on our own. We're just carnal. We're just weak. We're just frail. And we're like groping in the darkness, scripture says. We don't really even know where we're going, what we're doing. That's why we really desperately, desperately need to hear from God. He will get us through life. Amen. Every trial and every assault upon your life can be endured and overcome if you hear God's voice. Think how reassuring it is when you got on the phone with somebody in the middle of a crisis and you heard somebody from your family, whether you're a parent or a loved one, you heard their voice and it was so reassuring. It brought a confidence to you hearing their voice. His is the voice of reality. Man, this is about to go down and there'll be no shucking and jiving. This is about to happen. And if you're not serious about it, you're going to be swept away with the rest of the nonsense. This is the real deal, man. His is the voice of reality. If you do this, then that will happen. You better sit down right now and think about what's happening here. Do that first. That's the voice of reality. His is the voice of reason. Second, hey, man, you know, you need to think about what you're doing and everything is going to have a consequence or a reaction. There will be a result of what you're doing here. Amen. What you need to do right now is this, and God will lay out a plan for you. He'll tell you what's wrong with your life. He'll show you which roads you need to take, which steps, whatever it takes, the train of thought. He will give you the direction. He will give you reason. He'll give you practical things you can do, man. Thirdly, that he is the voice. His is the voice of faith and future dominion in your promised land. If we would simply call on him, he'll show up and then simply believe and it will happen and you will become blessed. We need to hear his voice of hope and possibilities and future destiny. I just read this evening how the spies went into the promised land and they came back and they gave a report about how awesome the land is and we can take it. Let's go right now. And the people said, no, you can't do that. The other spies, the other 10 spies, they said, they're like giants. We're like grasshoppers. You know, it's true. There's giant grapes. There's great. It's a wonderful place to be, a land flowing with milk and honey. We can't do it. The people spoke of stoning those two spies who spoke highly of the future. You're going to have to be ready to believe God and listen for his voice, because his voice is the voice of opportunity for you and I. Amen. His voice is the voice of faith. Believe God. We will possess our promised land together, my friend. Secondly, let's change the order here and maintaining a softened heart. Amen. How easy it is to get a hardened heart, man. Our need is to keep a softened heart. The heart of a baby. Some people say, as a pastor, or this could go for anybody here, you have to have, the skin of a rhino, but the heart of a baby. If you want to make it through life, if you want to live as a Christian, you have to have an exterior that can handle the assaults and the torture and the effects against you, but still have a heart that is soft like the heart of a mother. Amen. We have to maintain a softened heart. That means it's so easy and natural, especially when things don't go your way and you have a fit because things aren't happening the way you want them to happen. They're not happening fast enough. They're not developing the way that you planned. And a man plans his steps, but the way of a man is ordered from the Lord. Our ego gets bruised by the situation. Maybe a person or a group of people. And in our scripture, the fathers or the leaders that were there in the wilderness, they were getting disenfranchised with Moses' leadership. They said, Moses, he married a black woman. He married a person who's a non-Israelite. And they started to chide and to speak bad about him. And God said, you're messing with the wrong dude. You need to look out what you're saying about him. Because I've chosen him. And there are some serious consequences for their heart that was getting hard. We need to guard our hearts. Amen. From getting stony and inflexible. I preached a few weeks ago on having a new heart, a heart that's flexible, you need to put new wine into new wineskins. Otherwise, both are going to burst and be wasted. We need to have a flexibility in our heart. We need to, fifthly, keep our minds open to what God wants and what God expects from us. Amen. It is so hard to keep the prophecies that have been given us right before our eyes.
Right.
We forget them so easy. God has promised you life. He's promised you blessing, health, and finances, and revival in your life. It's so hard to keep remembering those things. We have to maintain a soft heart toward God and toward other people. God doesn't want us to be stuffy, old, pious gas bags. He doesn't want us to be religious and stuck up or hardened hearts. Everything's got to go this way. You know, you got the rules, the people who are always, you know, pushing their rules upon us. Amen. Charles Dickens has quoted this. He said, "Have a heart that never hardens, and a temper that never tires, and a touch that never hurts." And thirdly, departing from God is probably one of the most dangerous things that we can ever do. Take heed, verse 12, it says, "Brethren, lest there be any of you with an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God." So having an evil heart is our desperate need to have a sense of humor and continue to believe God for all his promises will come true. If when you get in a funk or in a temptation, amen, the devil throws it at you, your heart can become evil. You'll be bent on doing things that are wicked, things that are outside of God's will. That's going to get you away from God, take you out of his will. Unbelief is a sin that the children of Israel were experiencing. Unbelief. It is evil. It does not glorify God. Many people say, you know, there's, you know, drugs and alcohol. Well, he's a murderer. Charlie Manson should go to hell. Right? But how many here, you have been racist or you have held people under your control or manipulated them? And you have ought against your brother. Jesus said it's just as bad as murdering somebody. So I'm saying that even unbelief is lined up in that same list of being covetous and rebellious and adulterers and all these other horrible things that people become sodomites and people that are fighting against God and people that are unbelievers will also be judged. It's a sin. God says, "Follow me," amen, "follow the leader." But you say, "No, I'm not going to do that because of your ego, because of your pride. I'm not going to follow God. I'm not going to do what he wants me to do. I'm not going to fall in line." So we don't believe God. We don't think that he has our best interest at heart. Unbelief says to God, anything he says to us, he say, "No, no thanks. I don't believe it. I don't want it. Move along. Go, 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 go." 2 Kings is a tremendous story about the four lepers. Amen. Samaria is held up by the enemy. And nobody's coming in. Nobody's going out. They're selling their children for breakfast the next day. Ooh, yummy. And there's no hope for them. And God makes a promise in the middle of that. 2 Kings 7, verse 19. "Then that officer who had answered the man of God and said, 'Now look, if the Lord would make the windows in heaven, could such a thing be?'" God says, "I'm going to make provision for you. I'm going to change the economy in a moment's time. I can do that. I own the cattle on 1,000 hills. Everything is under my control." And the officer says, "That's impossible." And he said that, as he said that, The man of God said, in fact, you shall see it with your eyes, but you shall not eat of it. The official who did not believe what the prophet Elisha had prophesied about the famine being lifted, and consequently, he was judged when the people heard that the army was left and they ran out of the city. They trampled him to death because of his unbelief. Don't let that be you. Don't let that be your testimony, that you didn't believe God. And when the revival came, you were there and you just got wiped out, trampled to death. Going with God means we're going to take him at his word. We will follow him wherever he wants us to go, believing God for every miracle that he plans to do. Hallelujah. Secondly, I want to talk about hardened hearts. We'll never hear from God. There's something, I don't know if I'm going to pronounce this right. Maybe some of you who are a little smarter than me can pronounce this. Atherosclerosis, sometimes called the hardening of the arteries, occurs when fat, cholesterol, and other substances build up in the walls of the arteries. These deposits are called plaque. Over time, the plaque can narrow the completely block the arteries and cause problems throughout the body. I mean, it's kind of like a spiritual condition that you and I suffer from time to time, that our lifeblood can't flow through our body from our heart because those arteries are constricted with all kinds of filth and crap and something called plaque. It's a useful diagnosis from so many hearts that get clogged up with self-interest or serious personal problems. Maybe unrepentant sin that you have, issues or attitudes or mindsets that you can't, it's a constriction in your heart and that blood can't flow to your body. You have a hardened heart, they say. Hardening of the arteries. You're hard-hearted. You're stubborn. How many times did God call those people hard-hearted and rebellious? He said, Moses, get out of the way because I want to wipe them all out. They're so unthankful. And Moses said, not so, Lord. Please don't ruin your good testimony. Think about the Egyptians. What are they going to say? This is what he said. You can read it in the scripture yourself. I'll start over with you, Moses, and your lineage. And he said, no, we won't do that. He talks God out of it. Because God was grieved because they were testing him. They were pushing God's buttons. It's a dangerous adventure. Verse 9, when your fathers tempted me. This morning we talked about you getting tempted. You and I getting tempted by the devil. We talked about us getting tempted. Well, here, you know, we're testing God. We're tempting God to, you know, to totally destroy us, wipe us out. And saw my works for 40 years. Verse 10, therefore I was grieved with that generation. And I said, they always err in their hearts. I mean, God said, you know what? I'm going to do nothing with you. Because your hearts are so hearted, I'm going to take anybody who's 20 years and younger, and they're going to come into the promised land. Even Moses didn't go. But Joshua and Caleb, they had a different heart. Think about it. They thought differently. They thought more creatively. They were ready to take the land. They believed God. When God said go, they said, we need to go and go now. They had a different spirit. Amen. Here's the biggest problem in grieving God is complaining. Complaining. Here's something they did with their mouths. Unfortunately, I guess if they just complained in their minds, many of us go through the mechanisms, the engines in our mind, and we think about things. Why isn't this happening? Blah, blah, blah. But talking about it, that's a different thing. Why isn't God doing this for us? Why isn't God helping us here? You know, there's something that comes out that turns into gossip, it turns into rebellion, and become very unfruitful and sickening to other people, like a disease almost. God heard those words and became so upset that the people were ungrateful for so many things. Let's break it down here. Let's talk about you for a minute here. And think about when you heard somebody talking about you behind your back, or you read about it on Facebook. How did that make you feel? Usually it wasn't of anything of any value, of any good. Maybe it was lies, or they were spreading dissension about you. How did that make you feel? You didn't like it, I know that. Those emotions. Think about the rage inside of God. First, he remembers their sufferings as they're in slavery. He hears their cries. Moses is called on to help the people get delivered. And Moses has the burning bush experience. God goes and says, look, my people's cries have come up before me. They're your people too, Moses. And I want you to go. So God's thinking about you and I also in this kind of situation. We need to thirdly remember that there were signs and wonders, and God miraculously breaks the power of the enemy, the demonic power that was holding them in bondage for over 400 years. They're free, and then they're delivered into the wilderness, a million people, and they're still complaining. They're murmuring. Murmuring is like a soft, low, indistinct sound that is produced by a person or a group of people speaking quietly or in distance, a subdued or private expression of discontent or dissatisfaction. We are thirsty. We are hungry. Moses, you should have just left us back in Egypt. We had leeks and garlic and all the fish we wanted to eat. It was so wonderful. Yeah, what about the slavery? You were working 12 hours a day. You know, your backs were ripped open. You forgot about that, didn't you? You forgot about your bondage. And then they were disobedient. God said, look, I want to provide for you. I'm going to give you this bread. What is it? It's manna. They made up a new word for it. What is it, manna? And he said, you know, go ahead and gather some throughout the week, but on the Sabbath day you shall gather none. They were disobedient with that. And God poisoned them at that point in time and judged them. They also contended with Moses' leadership, continually questioning God's chosen leaders. It's a very dangerous adventure to partake in. They even had Aaron create an idol. They were involved in idolatry and partying and drinking and immoral sex when Moses was up on the mountain and delayed. Numbers 14. Here's where it gets all summed up here. Verses 20 through 22. Then the Lord said, I have pardoned according to your word, but truly as I live, all the earth shall be filled with the glory of the Lord. Because all these men who have seen my glory and the signs that I did in Egypt and in the wilderness have put me to the test these 10 times and not heeded my voice. Amen. So let's talk about now. That was then. This is now. These are the things that you may be going through also. We're called to not grieve God's Spirit, it says in the New Testament. Amen. Ephesians 4, verse 29. Let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, for only what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers. Verse 30. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be ye kind toward one another, tender hearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you. We're called to not grieve the Holy Spirit. And that can happen when you complain about what God is doing or what God is not doing or what you have or what you don't have or about leadership. Amen. Many times we as Christians are surprised when something evil comes out of our mouths. But what we are so clearly revealing is what is inside of us. Because out of the abundance of our heart or the way that we're thinking, our mind speaks. And out of the abundance of our mouths, amen, we realize what we are thinking, because we can get very evil and be very crippled in our spirits. No rest is experienced. As originating as a biblical quote, no rest for the wicked. That proverb means evildoers will face eternal punishment. Popularity extended to mean that one's work never ceases. A closely related expression is no rest for the weary. A proverb that means one must keep on working no matter how tired they get. So we are promised, amen, that when we bring pleasure to God through our words and through what's going on in our minds and our thinking, our hearts are pure before God, and we will enter into a certain realm, a dynamic of rest. There's many that cannot relax in God's will because they're not interested in pursuing it. Rest is not exempt from those who are working for God, but is much needed rest for those who are running away from Him and away from His plan. Amen. The rest is assured when we decide to do whatever God has brought us to do. Amen. When you resolve in your heart that, look, I am not going anywhere. I am going to do what God has called me to do. I am going to serve Him with all my heart. You will enter into a certain kind of rest. You will not be fighting God anymore. There's such a joy when you completely surrender to God. And you give up all your affections and all the things that will keep you away from God, and you will surrender to Him. You will experience that rest. You will enter in to your promised land. It doesn't mean you don't have to stop fighting. It doesn't mean you're going to have to you just give up and everything's going to be done for you. I'm not saying that there's still work involved, but there's a rest that is enjoyed for the believer. It's experienced when we begin to fight against our enemies and against the demonic realm instead of fighting against God. We let Him do the fighting for us. We enter into that rest and that peace, amen, that comes. Amen, that God has promised us. There's no promised land for those, amen, who are a generation of complainers. There's no rest. They wandered for 40 years. And it was only the younger generation that was promoted, went over the Jordan with Joshua and Caleb into the promised land, into the first city, Jericho, the tithe city. Amen. The next generation was allowed to go in. All the original died out. The crusty, musty religious people. Men are not going to enjoy the revival and that God has planned. We've all got to position our hearts and just be like, God, I can't wait to see how you're going to make this happen. How are you going to be bringing people in, and somebody knows somebody, somebody knows somebody in a different state, far away, or perhaps on a street corner they heard somebody preaching and eternal life was deposited into them. I want to see how this whole thing is going to play out. That's the kind of heart that we need to have. New wine must be put into wineskins. Our decision to listen to the Holy Ghost, to obey His voice, will help us to overcome. Amen. And we need to begin to sow into the Spirit. Sowing into the Spirit means that we're going to reap everlasting life. If you're going to continually be complaining and grumbling and murmuring and griping about your problems, amen, you're never going to sow that seed of faith into your future destiny. Let's thirdly and lastly discuss the softening of our hearts. We need to become sensitive. Amen. And that means sensitive to the Holy Spirit. You can be sensitized. You can hear His voice, amen. You can also be touched by His presence. The spiritual gift of discernment is known as the gift of discernment, or distinguishing between spirits. The Greek word for the gift of discernment is diakrisis, the word describing being able to discern or to distinguish, to judge or appraise a person, a statement, a situation, or an environment. In the New Testament, it describes the ability to distinguish between spirits, 1 Corinthians 12:10, and discern between good and evil in, Hebrews 5, verse 14. The church needs to exercise this gift as a corporate body, but also individually. You can have that wisdom to feel and sense the Holy Spirit. Not only what God has spoken, what God is speaking, but how He's touching and how He's moving upon people. Now we need to look at life from a different perspective. When you think about a certain situation, amen, I want you to begin to think and say to God, well, what are you doing here? What is going on? What is going on behind the scenes? There's certain spiritual dimensions and principles and different things that are happening that are affecting other things, different realities that we really can't see or understand. We need to let the Holy Spirit teach us and train us to show us, amen, what is happening, amen. We need to understand that though we see through a glass darkly, this is 1 Corinthians 13, verse 12, we see things, it's not like I said before, we kind of go through life and we're kind of groping, we're in the dark, we're not able to see. We see life through a dark glass darkly. It's indistinguishable. We can't always see things with a specificity. We have to have a discerning of the spiritual realm so that we can even know what's going on. For now I know in part, but then I shall be known even as I am known. I shall know. Then we shall be face to face. But for now, we need to have the Holy Spirit to teach us and train us and to speak to us about what's going on around us, listening to the Holy Ghost. Sometimes God speaks in a very small, quiet voice. He may speak to you a voice of comfort. I know you are hurting, but God is concerned in this time. He's going to give you His voice of reassurance. Hey, look, it's going to be all right. I know, even in the most difficult times, you've screwed up or you're backslidden or you're going out of my will. But I want you to know that though you've made mistakes, I still love you and I am here for you. Secondly, we need to hear His voice of concern. This may be kind of a warning that something demonic is about to happen in your life. You need to pay attention. You need to wake up and you need to drink the coffee instead of the Kool-Aid. Amen. You need to be aware of what's happening around you. Thirdly, there's a voice of conviction that God will speak to you. This is this when the Spirit is screaming at you, you've sinned and you've done something horrible, and the Spirit of God is not trying to condemn you. Look, you lousy fool, look what you've done again. You're no good for nothing. He's not doing that. He's trying to convict you, to show you, yes, you messed up. And if you have a right heart, you can repent and come back to God. His desire is to not totally expunge you and put out that light, put out that little candle of hope in your life. He wants to heal you. Are you ready to repent tonight? Amen. Thirdly, we need to pray for discernment, especially when you're sailing in uncharted territory. You don't know what's going on. There's new things. You have a new job. You have new people in your life. You're not sure about the situation. Secondly, you need to pray that God quickens to your senses to realize what is transpiring, what is going on in behind the scenes in the demonic realm. When you're praying for a person, thirdly, or maybe you're in prayer, or maybe you're far away from them in a different state. You're physically not with them in the same city. And then, or maybe they're far away from you, backslidden spiritually. And then God will show you what they need to hear or what you need to do with them. And lastly, is becoming surrendered. Amen. The Bible promises that if we humble ourselves in the sight of the Lord, that He will lift us up. Amen. If we will have a proper perspective, amen, respond to preaching. When the Word of God is ministered, many times we play something called pitchfork Christianity. You hear something and we dig our pitchfork in the hay, we throw it and somebody in the back row, that's for brother so-and-so. I don't have that problem. That's not me. Somebody else. Over there, probably. God bless him. Amen. We need to be ready to accept his direction, whether it's a rebuke or correction. Maybe tonight it'd be consolation for you, an encouragement. Our prayer should quite simply be, Lord, please speak to me tonight. I'm lost, I'm broken, I'm desperate. Amen. Let's go ahead and close our eyes. Amen. Think about, nobody's moving around. Let's make this a holy time so God can begin to deal with people. Hebrews 4:12, the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even the division of soul and spirit, joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Amen. Tonight, perhaps, your heart's motives and intentions have led you down a road of rebellion and disobedience to God, whether it was with your mouth or it was with your moral lifestyle, your choices, drugs, alcohol, I don't know, whatever form of rebellion against God. It is critical that you understand that God is here tonight to forgive you, to show his love to you, to forgive you from all your sins, from all of your transgressions and the error of your way. He wants to heal your broken heart. Amen. He wants to bring you into your promised land, but there are problems, there are hindrances, and the greatest of these is your sin problem. You have multiplied sin upon sin. God wants to show you tonight that he died for your sins. He shed his own blood on the cross to pay for your sins in full. 100% remove every last one of them by his blood. There's no remission of sin without the forgiveness, the blood that Jesus has shed. And that dynamic is that if you will call on his name tonight and you will believe God, he'll forgive you for your sin. Whether you're not saved or perhaps you're backslidden tonight, that means that you were once on fire for God. You were once obedient to him, but the cares and the desires of your flesh became more important in your life and you decided to go your own way and you are out of God's will. I want to encourage you to come back to your Father, your Heavenly Father. He loves you. He is concerned with you. It's his love and his desire to repair that damage that you have created by your sin, by your separation. How many would there be tonight, whether you're not saved or you're backslidden, and you want to get your heart right with God? I want you to ask tonight, would you ask yourself, is this for me? Do I need to repent? Ask yourself the hard questions. Are you living for God like you should be living for God? And I'm going to ask you to raise your hand right now if you want to pray. You want to get your life back in order. You want to give your life to Jesus. Amen. Raise your hand. You want to pray with us. Hallelujah. And you're listening online, perhaps. You're not able to make it. COVID-19. Or for whatever reason, you're watching this in a different place, a different time. But you realize that there's sin in your life and that you are lost. And the choices that you've been making and that have led you down a road of bondage. And you have become enslaved by your sin. You are cursed with a curse. You have no joy in your life. You have no gladness. And I want to pray with you tonight. If that's you, I want you to close your eyes and pray this prayer. Say, Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner. I realize tonight that you have died for me. You have shed your blood on the cross that I can become a new person, a new creation. I repent of all my sin. Wash me thoroughly in your blood and make me a new creation. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's change the order of our service. Amen. This is for all those, amen, that perhaps you have been wandering in the wilderness in your faith and you're not quite there in your promised land and you've been complaining, you've vocalized your unbelief, you have erred in sinning, you have gone your own way, or perhaps you just not really doing what God wants you to do. I want you to come forward. You can pray at the altar. We're going to sing this song together. We're going to worship God. These altars are open right now for you if you'd like to come forward and pray. Together, hallelujah, till the Lord comes. Let's keep in prayer and keep believing God. Let's pray for the new folks that came this morning, those that are listening online. We greatly appreciate your faithfulness, and we're going to believe God together for outrageous, amen, revival here in Greece, New York. Let's give God praise, and then Brother David can pray for us. Hallelujah!
Give us the grace to open our eyes and see them as you bring them in. And we thank you, Lord, that you're preparing us all to go and be with you. We thank you, Lord, that you're coming to pick us up soon. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. God bless you. Have a great week. We'll see you Wednesday.
Thanks.